Good morning, and I would like to welcome everyone to this, the 11th meeting of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee in 2022. Can I remind those members who are joining virtually to place an R in the chat function on BlueJeans if they would like to come in on any of the issues. Our first agenda item is decision on taking business in private. Are the committee in agreement to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private? Agenda item 3 is consideration of the evidence that we're going to listen to today as item 2. And item 4 is consideration of the Lobbying Act impact assessment. Are the committee in agreement to take it in private? Yes. I'm very grateful for that. Our next agenda item is to take evidence as part of our future parliamentary procedures and practices evidence session. And joining us today on our first panel are the Right Honourable Karen Bradley, MP, who is Chair of the Procedure Committee in the House of Commons, and also Lord Gardiner of Kimble, who's the Senior Deputy Speaker at the House of Lords. Can I welcome you to this evidence session this morning? And perhaps can I start, if I can ask you, Karen Bradley, to perhaps just introduce yourself, introduce where the House of Commons is with regard to these matters, for about 2 minutes.
Chair, though I, as you say, chair the House of Commons Procedure Committee, and our responsibility in that committee is the conduct of public business. So, putting it simply, when business starts with an order and finishes with order, we do the bit in the middle. So that is in the House of Commons, Westminster Hall, in standing committees, bill committees, as you would know them, and also select committees when evidence is being taken, and therefore parliamentary privilege applies. I think that's the key point, that we are concerned with making sure that that public business is conducted in such a way and privilege is rightly observed. We also have the Privileges Committee, which deal with whether privilege has been abused, but we look at the procedures around conduct of public business. And in terms of the House of Commons and our current procedures, we are exactly as we were before the pandemic. We are now entirely back to every single procedure that we had prior to the COVID pandemic. Everything that was brought in was time limited and has stopped. The only thing that we are doing now differently from before the pandemic is that when we walk physically through the division lobbies to vote, instead of a clerk recording our name, we now record our name using our security pass on a pass reader, and that is how our name is recorded in the vote. But everything else is exactly as it was.
That's very helpful. Lord Gardiner, could I turn to you for a similar short introduction about where the House of Lords are at the moment?
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you to your committee for this opportunity. I think it's fair to say that as both houses, we reacted very swiftly to the pandemic and went from virtual to hybrid very quickly. And I think we achieved much by doing so. But as has been said in the House of Commons, we have returned to much of what we did before the pandemic in terms of procedure, because of loss of spontaneity and being a self-regulating house. It was felt by an overwhelming majority that we needed to return to previous procedures. But what we have retained is a number of issues. We have, for instance, continued with an extension in question time from 30 minutes to 40 minutes, private notice questions from 10 to 15. So we've retained some of those matters. And we've also, which I think is very important, we have an eligible scheme for members with long-term disabilities who will continue to be able to participate virtually. But we have 11 eligible members. And so we have achieved that. So far as voting is concerned, we adopted something called Peer Hub, which enabled all peers to vote using a Peer Hub situation. We are moving to, as in the House of Commons, to a pass reader situation. Our lobbies are narrower than the House of Commons, so we have retained Peer Hub because of social distancing reasons, but will be in the new session having pass readers. The other thing very quickly is on select committees, we have autonomy for committees, the select committees, and therefore they have the opportunity to take their meetings physically, virtually or hybrid. And we have had a very considerable number of witnesses very successfully through these means. We've upgraded our committee room facilities, but we do also think that ministers really ought to appear in person because we think the dynamic is more valuable. And those are some of the areas that we've been attending to.
Thank you. That's incredibly helpful. As you will both expect, I'm going to move around the committee members here who have various areas of interest to explore. But I would, with taking the privilege of convener, like to kick off to discuss something which almost should and rightly does predate the pandemic, which is the role of proxy voting, which is something that doesn't exist in the Scottish Parliament. Karen Bradley, if I can come to you first, would you like to sort of briefly explain how the proxy voting works in the House of Commons for the record? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. So we have, currently, there is only one category of Member of Parliament that can apply for a proxy vote, and that is a proxy vote for those taking baby leave. And baby leave is for fathers, mothers, adoptive parents, and also for those that have a miscarriage. And the proxy for, we've tried to mirror the length of time that a pregnant or a new parent would receive in terms of parental leave in the public in the private sector. In the public sector, any employee, 6 months for a mother and 2 weeks for a father. We also on that proxy vote, there is a provision which is that if you are on a proxy vote for baby leave, you are not allowed to participate in the proceedings of the House on the day you have a proxy vote, which is something that the committee is looking at because there have been representations that that is not acceptable. And that's because people had got used to during the pandemic proxy votes being available to everybody. Now, I would like to say on the record that I was firmly of the view that we should continue with the electronic voting on our phone, the member hub that we have that mirrors the peer hub that's in the House of Lords. I felt that a member actually having to press a button at the time of the vote and being part of the democratic process at that time meant that there was better engagement and that as members we were more alert to what was happening in the chamber. But the powers that be determined that they did not want us to vote by phone, which was a fantastic thing that the digital services in the House of Commons developed very, very quickly and was then subsequently adopted by the House of Lords. So we saw the House of Lords reaping the benefits of all that work. But we moved instead to a proxy system. And by the end of the pandemic, I think there were only about 10 members who didn't have a proxy vote. And we did have a point where, you know, the deputy chief whip of the governing party, the Conservative Party, was delivering something in the region of 330 votes at every vote, which, you know, I personally had a difficulty with in terms of what that looked like to the public. But it was exceptional circumstances, so I think we can understand that. But because during the pandemic we were able to participate in the chamber while still exercising our proxy vote, that has meant that on the baby leave standing order, we are now considering whether to decouple the participation in the chamber from the proxy vote. The other thing I will say is that we are conducting an inquiry at the moment. We've not completed that inquiry, but in the Commons we're conducting inquiries to whether to introduce a system of proxy voting for those in long-term sickness and or medical conditions. And I think we've all recognised that if somebody is away for a few weeks, 2-3 weeks, you know, it may be because you're on parliamentary business, it may be that there is a reason that you can't be there, but actually in most cases your constituents won't probably notice that you've been away, or if they do, then you can explain it as to, you know, a short-term absence for parliamentary or constituency reasons. But if you're away for longer than that because you're having long-term medical treatment, or you have a condition that means that Staying late in Parliament and voting, you know, as we have been doing this week, close to midnight, is not conducive to your health, then it probably is something that we need to consider, whether a proxy vote should be given to people in that situation to allow them to still participate in the democratic process, but not have to stay for that vote, which may, you know, just being there may damage their health. And so we are considering that within the committee at the moment.
That's extremely helpful, and I'm sure as a committee here we will follow your investigation onto that. If I pick up one aspect of that, because my understanding is, and please correct me if I'm wrong, that the application for a proxy vote effectively goes to the Speaker, who authorises it. Is there any control about who can hold the proxy after that? Is it the member's own decision? Because a number of people have pointed out to us that individuals hold, basically the whips hold the proxy, whether that was an active decision or something that just came about because of circumstances. And I know that you've indicated your view on it. What would be your preferred way of someone holding a proxy vote?
So it is entirely down to the member as to who holds the proxy vote. I know in Wales, when they introduced proxies for the pandemic, they did allocate the proxies to the whips. And likewise, I believe Canada did the same when they were operating proxies. But we have always kept it that you gave the proxy to your member of choice. And for baby leave, that will be, you know, it's usually somebody that you're close to, somebody you're friends with, somebody you trust, somebody perhaps in the same sort of political persuasion as you in terms of moral issues, because I think that's where this gets very difficult. It's fine when you're voting with the party whip, but once you get into moral issues or perhaps things where you have a constituency issue, expecting your deputy chief whip to rebel. And to be fair to our deputy chief whip during the pandemic, he voted against the government more than any member of a government has ever done before. But he was exercising a proxy on behalf of people, and I include myself in this, who did actually vote against the government on certain measures, including some of the pandemic measures. And he did do so in good faith, and all credit to Stuart Andrew, who was the deputy at that time, for being honourable and doing the right thing. We ended up with the whips taking the votes, and that was true in all parties, because we just didn't want to have people in the Commons any more than was necessary. Social distancing, the state of the pandemic at the time, the fact that you know, we were trying to control the virus, meant that we were really dissuaded from being physically in the building. Although, as I say, you could physically turn up and speak if you wished to, or you could speak on virtually if you preferred. But the whips took the proxy votes at that time. I think we need to just remember, though, it was an exceptional time. And in normal circumstances, normal times, the parental leave proxies are allocated to whichever member the member on the proxy wishes to have them.
That's very helpful. Lord Gardiner, can I turn to you? Because my understanding from ancient school history is that the House of Lords had proxy many hundreds of years ago, but abandoned it. What's the position at the moment? And as my understanding is, there's no formal proxy system, but is there a sort of another method that is used to assist members to vote if they're unable to be there?
Well, thank you. You're absolutely right. There is actually no provision in the Lords for proxy voting. Indeed, our standing orders prohibit such. So it has not come forward for a consideration, I think, indeed during this pandemic time, because we thought that the app that was devised, which we call Peer Hub, which people could vote anywhere, and then as the situation improved somewhat, from September 2021, members were required to confirm on the app that they were present on the parliamentary estate before voting. And now, as I say, the House voted that we should proceed to return to using the lobbies with the pass reader, which we believe will assist accuracy, speed, accessibility, and so forth. With the rider, as I say, that we have a distinct scheme which I should emphasise is for people with a long-term disability who wish to continue with active participation, and that there is a group of us that consider mindful of the definition of disability, but obviously we do need to be mindful that this is not, in our view in the House, is not an option as a sort of pre-retirement or because of frailness. This is absolutely for people to actively participate, but may not be in a position to attend the House all day, may wish to participate virtually at different parts of the day. So it's a very distinct scheme that we have come forward with, and I think is well appreciated.
Thank you. That's very helpful. And as always with committees, I'm conscious of time and I'm not going to steal any more as convener. But I'm going to hand you over to the very capable hands of Colette Stevenson. Colette.
Thanks, convener, and good morning to the both of you. I wanted to sort of explore... Good morning. I'll just repeat what I said there. So thanks, convener, and good morning to the both of you. It's lovely to have you here. I wanted to sort of explore about your views on virtual and hybrid proceedings. And, you've touched upon several areas and where it works and whatnot. And I know that from some of the paperwork that we got, there was a sense that there was more contributions throughout the pandemic. And I know that the actual virtual voting system within the House of Lords increased as well. So I just wanted to ask Karen whether, is there a shared view within the legislation on whether there should be different rules in relation to virtual participation for chamber business and committees to basically try and preserve the debate within the chamber?
So there were different rules during the pandemic for bill committees, for Westminster Hall, for the chamber and for select committees. Start with the chamber. We introduced hybrid participation in the chamber. That meant you could participate physically and you could participate like this on a screen. The difficulty then, where people did feel frustration, was that it had to be very pre-planned and organised. There was a call list. You couldn't intervene. There was very little debate within the debates. And actually, we only introduced virtual participation in debates very late on in the pandemic. We had participation by the questions very early on, but we didn't introduce it for debates until much later into the pandemic, because there was a feeling that there wasn't going to be that debate, the cut and thrust of the commons that people were looking for. And I think you're right to say that what we saw was more members participating. There is no doubt about it. And actually, the statistics are very clear that it was more women who participated virtually. People who live further away were able to participate more than they perhaps would otherwise have been able to do. But the House of Commons decided that they did not want to continue with any virtual participation once the pandemic was over. And this was a decision by the House. This is the majority view of the House. And certainly on my committee, there was a majority view of the committee that we needed to return to pre-pandemic participation. Now, on bill committees, there was never any virtual participation. And that's one of the criticisms we're seeing now around the scrutiny of, and particularly in statutory instruments, which during the pandemic, it was just so much of what was changing was being changed through statutory instruments. And there was a real sense that there simply wasn't the scrutiny. And I suspect we will find, I don't know if you've seen Hannah White's book, which has recently been published, Held in Contempt, which talks about that lack of scrutiny and the way that instruments were debated after they'd actually come into force. So there was no opportunity for members to have a say. And we had committees that were the small committees upstairs, where there would just be the quorum number of five. So it would be the minister, the shadow minister, the two whips, and another member from the governing party who would be part of that debate. So therefore, things were going through without debate and without scrutiny. And that is something I think we will come back to rue. Westminster Hall, we did allow virtual participation. There's no questions, of course, in Westminster Hall. So it was another one that was very late to be introduced. But we did then start to allow virtual participation in the debates. Again, that has gone. The area where I think there is a sense that the House may want to move is on select committees. So we've always been able to take evidence remotely on select committees, but members have to be in the room. And the liaison committee, which is the committee made up of all the chairs of select committees, did make representations that there should be something around the chair's discretion to allow members to participate virtually. And I became a victim of this when they said it wasn't possible. I contracted COVID in the new year. This was the week that the leader of the House was coming in to take evidence. I could not participate as the chair of the committee in questioning the leader of the House, who is the minister that is our minister on our committee. I couldn't even be in the room virtually. I had to watch on the Parliament TV channel, and I couldn't take part in any way. Now, you know, clearly I could message members of the committee and I could make my points through letting other people know some of the things that I've been listening to. But it's very frustrating to be a chair of a committee and not able to scrutinise the minister that your committee, that reports to your committee in effect, because I couldn't participate virtually. And I think there's a sense that many chairs, I'm not saying it's all chairs, but many chairs of select committees would like to reintroduce virtual participation for members, particularly while we still have relatively high levels of COVID. And also, you know, the medical advice being that even if it's not COVID, you're not tested positive, but you're under the weather, you shouldn't come in, because we've learned the lesson now that, you know, this sort of, you know, going on, carrying on regardless is perhaps one of the reasons that COVID spread so quickly in those early days. So I think there is a view within the select committees that we would like to have virtual participation back for members of select committees. But I don't get the sense that at the moment the House has a majority for virtual participation in any other of our business.
Thanks very much, Karen. That's really interesting. And I know that one of my colleagues will probably come in on the scrutiny aspect of it. I want to pose that question to Lord Gardiner and see what his views are.
Thank you very much. Well, the House of Lords did move quite swiftly. So we actually started virtual proceedings in April 2020 and then hybrid proceedings in June 2020. So we had quite a time of having those proceedings. And as I say, I think a lot of legislation was scrutinised. But I think there was a strong feeling that the scrutiny and the proceedings were not as dynamic and not as immediate. And therefore, the move of the mood of the House by a majority was that we should, as the situation improved and that the pandemic and the medical advice was that we would return to previous procedures. But interestingly, a matter of detail, but we did decide that we would retain speakers' lists for oral questions by a majority. And so we continued with that process, whereas we got rid of speakers' lists for everything else because it lost the dynamic of debate. The House concluded, having gone through some months of having the speakers' list for oral questions, but that they became anodyne, that ministers weren't under the pressure that they should be. And I say this as a former minister who was one of the few that enjoyed oral questions, and that atmosphere was that you didn't get the right dynamic. And so actually the House decided that they would return to having 10 minutes for each question, but with a free flow. Interestingly, the free flow has probably increased the numbers of people that are posing questions, because it was more staccato when it was a list, and there was a tendency for some people to ask too long a question and the minister therefore to reply with too long an answer. So in fact, I think there is a feeling now that we tried an experiment with the speaker, continuing the speaker's list, but it didn't quite work for the House. Just picking up very quickly on the select committees, I think that very strongly the mood in our House is that the autonomy that each committee has to decide how best to conduct their business has worked well. And not only for members, but more particularly, I think, in terms of the range of witnesses that have become much more prevalent, so that our international committees are interviewing people all around the world. Those are the areas that I think we've had successes and will wish to retain.
No, thanks very much for your answer. And we have a similar problem here in Scotland, in our Scottish Parliament, with regards to succinct questions and answers. So we're well aware of it. But one of the things I wanted to ask, and I'll come back on to Lord Gardiner, is if virtual participation was limited to certain circumstances, I mean, what are your views on how decisions about virtual participation should be managed? Do you think it should be like through political parties, the speaker, or at the discretion of the individual?
Well, our process is that our strategic direction comes from our... Can you hear me?
Yes, you've just come back on, Lord Gardiner. We missed the start of that answer.
I'm so sorry. The House of Lords Commission issues what I call the strategic direction, and then the Procedure and Privileges Committee consider and bring forward reports to the House. So it's for the House to decide, being a self-regulating House, all of these processes and procedures now come to the House. The worlds are truncated because of during the hybrid situation where the House agreed that changes had to be made very promptly, and therefore I think 11 different guidances during this period were issued. But our process of change comes through the Procedure and Privileges Committee putting forward proposals to the House, and then the House debating it, and then agreeing to the report or not. And I've had instances of both where it's been agreed or that we've taken it back for further consideration. So that's the process that we get our sort of buy-in from the House. And also the structure of the Procedure and Privileges Committee, with obviously having a large number of crossbench as well as political parties, obviously the membership of that committee very much takes the whole range of the House of Lords.
Thank you very much. Karen, do you have any views on that at all?
So the Commons is different in that there is no... The hierarchy is very difficult to explain, and there isn't one body that is responsible for any one bit of what we do. So certain things are at the discretion of the Speaker. The Speaker, for example, introduced call lists and then could reintroduce them at any time. The Speaker was able to determine the way voting worked. These are not set down in standing orders. They are not prescribed. They are really down to the Speaker to make a determination on. So the Commission would have a role in that, but the Speaker ultimately decides. Anything that requires a change to standing orders, though, whilst my committee can make recommendations, it's only the government that can put those motions on the order paper. And the government owns and controls the order paper and is able to determine the business. And so we did have a situation where when we were trying to introduce virtual participation in debates, the government had put that motion on the order paper. I'm not going to comment how willing they were or not to do that, but they put that motion on the order paper in such a way that it couldn't be amended, or if it was amended, it wouldn't proceed. And that meant that members were very frustrated because it was called a nod or nothing. So either it went through or it didn't. There was no debate and no option. And then a debate was sort of concocted and people got very frustrated because they felt that the members of the House were not being heard. And I do have to put on the record that I do believe House business should not be whipped business. I think that recent development, and it is a very recent development, of putting a three-line whip on House business is a very dangerous precedent, because this is not a government. The House is there to scrutinise government. Of course, Parliament exists partly so that government can get its business done, but it also exists to scrutinise. And if the government is determining how that scrutiny happens, and the government is whipping its members to ensure that they determine how that scrutiny happens, scrutiny will not be as good. And even if it is as good, no one will quite believe it's as good. So I would firmly say the house business should never be whipped, but we do have that difficulty at the moment.
Okay, really interesting, and thanks very much. No further questions.
Thank you very much, Colette. And actually, probably moving on to the scrutiny, I'm going to hand you over to the capable hands of Edward Mountain, who I think will have a few questions on it. Edward.
Thanks very much, Convener. And I probably should put on the record that for the last year, I have had to be in hybrid or virtual format with no choice of my own. I think views on it, but Karen, if I could come to you to start with. Is that talk about and get your view of spontaneity and the ability for people to make interventions and actually participate in debate when you were hybrid. I mean, we have a wonderful system in Scotland that we know the debates for the next 3 weeks, and the whips choose the speakers, and the speakers are notified to the presiding officer, and the presiding officer calls them, and that's it. And you can't make any interventions if you're remote. Did you find that it was as sterile as that when you were hybrid, Karen?
Yeah, so it wasn't whips who decided who spoke. You put into a call list, and on questions, on statements and questions, it was a lottery. The first out of the hat were the ones that were called, keeping the balance, so it was always government, then opposition benches. And I think I'll make the point, and Lord Gardiner touched on this, that I was a minister before. If I'd known exactly everybody was going to ask me a question in a question time, that would have been a much easier process, because I would have had a good idea of the kind of question they might ask. Whereas in the system that we've always had with topicals and follow-ups to substantive questions, you never really know who's going to come in. And I will make the point that if you are a minister and you want your officials to be completely on the ball, and we want you to be completely on the ball as a minister, that prepping for oral questions when you have no idea who's going to ask you what is incredibly important. And it's really part of the challenge that we have ministers to their officials to make sure a policy is robust. Because if you can't answer a simple question that's put you on the floor of the House that you don't expect, then there's probably something wrong with the policy. But, you know, I think it's worth making that point. And good scrutiny makes for better government. That's another point worth making. In the debates, the real frustration was that we had no intervention. Even if you were participating physically, you couldn't intervene. You couldn't intervene on someone who was participating virtually. So once the screen came on, then that was it. It was the person on the screen who spoke with no intervention, nobody interacting with them. And you know, it is a debating chamber, and that interaction is incredibly important. And we ended up with a very frustrating debate where most speakers getting no more than 3 minutes. They read a speech into the record, which means, yes, you've got a speech on the record, but there was no furthering of the issue. Now, you know, I was a whip at one point, and, you know, whips would say that you can go and listen to a wonderful debate, but it really shouldn't change the way you vote. I'm not sure. I think that is such a good policy, but, you know, most whips would probably believe that that is the right way to do things. And, you know, yes, have the debate, but, you know, then go and vote with the government or vote with the opposition, depending on your party allegiance. But I do think you need to have that cut and thrust of debates and the ability in the debate to move the argument on and to consider the argument more fully. And we didn't have that. It was very sterile. Now, the frustration for me is I think there are technical ways that we could have looked at doing interventions, but there was a reluctance to even try. Because I suspect people just didn't want to find it might be quite good, and they would much rather go back to fully physical. I suspect at some point in the future, we will want to look at this again. There certainly isn't an appetite to do it at the moment based on the experiences during the pandemic.
Okay, can I go to Lord Gardiner next and just say that our committee system is slightly different in the Scottish Parliament, because it is effectively our second chamber to scrutinise legislation. And whilst committees can take evidence very effectively, do you think they're in a position to scrutinise legislation, i.e. on a line-by-line basis, if they're doing it remotely, and they're not round the table posing the question. So if you had 200 amendments on one bill, which I had, do you think that could be done remotely, Lord Gardiner, or do you think that would be impossible?
Well, I think having taken the Agriculture Bill and the Fisheries Bill through the House of Lords during this period, it was done, but it could have been more dynamic if we had had the system, I think, that we have now of meeting more fully, because I think that the whole ethos of our assemblies is that discourse and exchange. And I think picking up what Karen Bradley has said is one of the reasons I think the House of Lords wish to return to having the physical sense in the chamber and in the Grand Committee was precisely because of that lack of ability to pose questions, to challenge a minister. It became more formulaic. There wasn't the sort of electricity, particularly with question time, but particularly in a house where the whole essence is that we are seeking to scrutinise line by line, our committee stages, which are either in Grand Committee or in the Chamber, as you know, that absolutely the challenge and the ability for a number of members to play in with each other, trying to get the right words in and discussing an amendment, I think that became, I found, much more sterile. And I have to say, as a minister, I always wanted to be at the dispatch box because it was very difficult to have dealt with it, I think, dealing with it, if I'd been remotely somewhere. So my experience, but also the sense of the House, was we wanted to return because that spontaneity of challenge and the fact that ministers really didn't have a satisfactory sort of scrutiny of their proposals this way. I think that's why the House overwhelmingly wanted to return, because of those facets, recognising, I think, that all of us in all legislatures have done our very best to achieve legislation, even if it might have been better in the form that we're seeking to undertake business now.
Thank you. And Convener, I have one more question, if I may, which is to Karen, which and I've heard Lord Gardiner's point on it, and it chimes with me about the fact that ministers, if they're not at the dispatch box, just talk time out, and you can't intervene, you can't shut them up, you can't get them back on topic, and they just waffle away for the 20 minutes that they've got for their questions, giving you non-answers. Do you agree with my summation of that? And do you think that ministers, when they're participating in any event, should be in front of the committee or in front of the parliament, so there's no way to wiggle out of answering the question? Well, there is always a way, less of a way.
So certainly right at the beginning, when we first introduced the hybrid model, which was you could participate by Zoom to ask a question, but the Speaker was very keen that ministers should be in the room to answer the question. Now, there were some who, for very good medical reasons or other reasons, were not able to do so. And I think I'll say it wasn't just ministers. I think there became a difficulty. If you're in the chamber and you start to go on too long asking your question, Mr. Speaker catches your eye pretty darn quickly. Mr. Speaker, it's very clear that the House is losing patience. You'll start to hear people saying, you know, sit down, is it intervene, is it lunch yet? You know, there'll be somebody will make some quip that will put you off your stride. Nobody really can go on that too long when they're in the chamber. If you're on a screen, you can just keep on going. And you know, that is true of all of them. It was true of everybody participating, ministers and participants. But you know, it's also true. I mean, I did quite a lot of media over that time. And I remember speaking to one of the journalists afterwards who said, it's really difficult to keep time when you're on a screen because I can't catch your eye and say, news is coming up in a moment, could you sit down? So I think that is one of the problems of any virtual participation. It's much too easy to go on and not be stopped.
Thank you, Karen. And yes, I agree. Having been a convener, it's very easy in a committee room to turn off the minister's microphone so he shuts up. You can't do that remotely. Thank you very much, convener, and thank you.
Thank you, Edward. And finally, I realise that time is tight. but I'm going to hand over to Bob Doris. Bob?
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask a couple of questions, I suppose, around recruitment, retention and diversity of elected representatives. And I'm just wondering, we know Mr Mountain's had to be hybrid for a significant amount of time, and hybrid has supported that. It's interesting to hear in relation to proxy voting in at Westminster for baby leave, but also looking at long-term sickness and conditions. We lost some parliamentarians from the last session, very high-quality parliamentarians, because of work-life balance. So, more generally, I wonder, maybe go to Karen first, if that's okay. I mean, putting to one side that we have to make the technical and the dynamic aspects of hybrid parliaments work effectively, what are the benefits in retaining members of your legislature or any legislature with hybrid parliaments in terms of that work-life balance and retaining perhaps mothers who just don't get to spend time with their family and something's got to give? So, Karen, I'm interested to hear what your thoughts are on that.
Yeah, and I think that is the other side of the argument. Look, there's no doubt that the scrutiny that we had during COVID wasn't as good. But let's get back to the reality. If it hadn't been for introducing that hybrid parliament right at the sort of straight after Easter 2020, we would have had no scrutiny. So the idea that this was a bad thing is just wrong. It was just plain wrong. We were one of the few parliaments that did sit through the whole pandemic that were able to do some scrutiny. Now, I think the problem we had was that we sort of imposed a hybrid system on a model that is very physical based. The model of scrutiny that we have in Parliament does require people to be there to get the maximum benefit from it. But the question shouldn't be, oh, well, we'll just get rid of hybrid because it clearly can't work on the system. Do we need to reform the system to allow for more hybrid participation? Because you're absolutely right. You know, the statistics were clear. The people participating virtually were more women were participating virtually than the overall average in the House. We had more people with long-term conditions who simply wouldn't have been able to be anywhere near, but not even a parliament today where, you know, COVID is not the public health emergency it was back in the lockdown era, but simply just couldn't travel. And, you know, we all know of those instances, and we've had some very, very powerful evidence given to my committee on this. So I think there is a point, and maybe it's a point that comes from lots of other things that we're discussing at the moment around culture and approach and attitude, that maybe we have to look more fundamentally at the way Parliament operates to make it culturally and physically a better place for all people to participate. We want Parliament to represent the public. And it's not going to represent the public if we insist on it being like a sixth form debating society.
Karen, I'm going to come back to you again, just very briefly. I'm hybrid. I'm remote working today. It allowed me to feed my baby and give my son breakfast this morning, albeit a constituency regeneration event this lunchtime. And I will, the one time this week, I'll get to have dinner with my family. I don't want to do that every week for hybrid working, but it gives a work-life balance. I've overcome the barriers. The MSPs, the MPs that are in Parliament, we've already overcome those barriers, despite the fact you don't always get the work-life balance you want. For those who are not putting themselves forward for election, are there barriers that exist that the hybrid Parliament could overcome, be that those from ethnic minority backgrounds, those with disabilities, those with long-term conditions, those with young families, or any other group? So looking at it from the other end, this is supporting me currently, but I had already overcame these barriers to be elected in the first place. Could hybrid Parliament do something to make sure all our parliaments look a lot more like the people we wish to represent?
I think as I say, it's not just about hybridity, it's around the whole way we work. And I would go back to our select committee system, which is very similar to the committee that I'm giving evidence to today. I don't think that stopping members of a committee from being able to participate unless they are physically in a room is actually helping the debate and helping scrutiny. The way our select committee system works does allow for a hybrid approach and for virtual participation, not just of witnesses, but also of members of the committee. And I think, you know, that is a model we perhaps need to look at. We've got a lot of challenges in Westminster. We've got restoration and renewal that may or may not be happening, which is going to force us into changing the physical way we operate. We've got the challenges of the culture that is so live at the moment and is so in the headlines. We've got the challenges of how do we make sure scrutiny really works so the government is properly scrutinised, even with a massive majority. All of those challenges, I think this is a point at which we need to think very hard about the parliament we want to be, so that we can attract the best people that do make parliament look like the rest of the country, make people look at parliament and say, yes, that person is like me, that person, I could be one of them. And this is not just about hybridity, it is about everything we do.
But can I just check, Karen Bradley, does hybridity have a role to play and encouraging people from underrepresented groups to step forward and increase the pool of talent for those that may wish to seek election? You said it's more than hybridity, of course it is, but does hybridity have a role to play within that?
I think just like every workplace in the country, we all now know the way that we can operate. Look, we were able to hear from President Zelensky in the House of Commons because of hybridity. We are able to have meetings with, and I'm regularly participating in meetings with Ukrainian MPs, hearing what's happening on the ground because of hybridity. This simply wouldn't have been possible. We would never have thought to do it until the pandemic showed us that we can. The whole world is looking at different ways of doing things and making sure more people can be part of it. My background was a tax accountant in the city. I see my old colleagues are now operating in a different way to attract different people into the profession. It has to be right that we look at this.
That's really helpful. Well,
sorry, my apologies, yes. Bob. I just need to cut across you because of time, and just to see whether or not Lord Gardiner of Kimble has any comments, because he needs to depart in the very near future.
That's precisely what I was going to ask, convener. Lord Gardiner, I'm conscious that it's not an elected chamber, but we've seen the benefits of getting greater contributions within the House of Lords. So I'd welcome your reflections on this also.
Thank you. Thank you very much. One of the reasons why we decided to open this eligible scheme for members with long-term disability was very much along the lines of wanting the active participation of members who had, as I say, long-term disabilities, many of whom wanted the option of coming to the House, wanting to play their part in the House, but also wanting the option that there would be moments of the day or periods when they would need to not be in the chamber. So one of the reflections of what we had was very much on this area of disability. The other thing I'd say is that very quickly on the select committees, whereas we have this autonomy and it is working very well, I think there is a general consensus that if a select committee is asking for evidence from a minister, that the dynamic is much better if the minister is there physically. And I think that has come across, and I think both ministers and members of committees have observed to me that has been a better dynamic. So I think in the sense of whether one's hybrid or not, I think that what we've tried to do is provide this option for people to attend, because overwhelmingly everyone who's eligible has said, I wish to attend whenever I possibly can. They want to be absolutely on equal partnership in the chamber, in the Grand Committee, whatever. But it provides that opportunity, which is working, I believe, very well. But thank you for asking me.
Thank you, Lord Gardiner. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Bob. I hope both witnesses wouldn't mind if our clerks were to correspond with you to have the option of placing some more evidence on the record in respect of some other matters. But can I thank the Right Honourable Karen Bradley for attending this morning? And can I thank you, Lord Gardiner of Kimble, for attending and giving evidence, which has been most helpful. Thank you very much indeed. I'm now going to adjourn this meeting for a short time while we change over panels. And can I welcome people back to this meeting and indeed to our second panel. And joining us today are Dennis Norton, TD, who's a member of the DAL, and Gerrit Vermilion, Director of Legislative Services from the Flemish Parliament. And I'd like to welcome both gentlemen to this meeting. We were going to be joined by the Right Honourable Lawrence Skelly, the President of the Tynwald, but unfortunately, the Right Honourable Lawrence Skelly is unwell. So on behalf of myself and the committee, can I hope the President makes a swift and full recovery?
Mm-hmm. We'll begin shortly. There doesn't appear to be anyone on the screen.
I think we're broadcasting fine. I was about to...
Sorry.
No, that's all right. That's all right. The wonders of technology. Can I again introduce Dennis Norton from the DAL? Good morning. As you are aware, the committee are looking at the future procedures here based on our experiences coming out of COVID and the use of hybrid parliament facilities so that people can contribute both from within chambers and remotely. Would you like to make a sort of opening statement so that the committee are aware of what the circumstances were in the DAL?
Mr. Yeah, just very briefly, and thank you for inviting me to contribute to the evidence this morning. So we're slightly unique, I suppose, compared to some of the other parliaments within our catchment, in that we have a written constitution that can only be amended by the Irish people. And our constitution, Bunrock na Héireann, clearly states that the Houses of the Oireachtas, both Houses of Parliament, the Dáil and the Seanad, shall sit near or in the City of Dublin or in such other place as may from time to time be determined. So there is a clear, unambiguous statement in our constitution that Parliament must sit in a physical place in the vicinity of Dublin. Also, there within the Constitution, there's provision that decisions, questions of each House should be determined by a majority of the members present and voting. And again, that's written into our Constitution. And the third aspect then that is relevant to the discussion this morning is the issue of privilege and parliamentary privilege. And under our Constitution, again, utterances made in either House of Parliament have absolute privilege. And the legal interpretation of that is that they must be made physically in the Parliament itself. So effectively, this means that for all plenary sittings and public committee hearings, members must be within the precincts of Leinster House or within the Dublin area. And during the most restrictive element of the COVID-19 restrictions, we had a dual campus approach here in Leinster, in the Dáil. We actually had the plenary session taking place in the National Convention Centre on the other side of the River Liffey. The committees were still operating from the traditional Leinster House complex. And for members involved in plenary, during the main restrictions, only one third of members were present in the chamber at any one time. So there was a rota put in place, one third of members contributing, one third of members voting. So one of the first things that colleagues wanted to see change was that abolition of the reduced voting numbers, not just because they wanted to be able to record their position on a particular motion before the Dáil, but also because it provided them with an opportunity to meet with and engage with ministers and colleagues. And I'm happy to go into further detail in relation to that later. Now, on foot of all of this changing dynamic, the Ceann Comhairle, the Speaker of the Dáil, established in March 2021 a family-friendly and inclusive Parliament forum, where we had the staff of the Oireachtas as well as the members of the Oireachtas looking at how we could make Parliament far more family-friendly. And one of the issues that was looked at was the introduction of hybrid sittings in terms of the Dáil, the Seanad and committee business, where members would actually choose to participate in certain business remotely or be physically present. Now, to do this, would require extending the designation of Parliament to other physical locations. So the way that is being looked at in relation to this is to introduce regional hubs located in existing state buildings where members from surrounding constituencies could participate in certain Dáil, Seanad or committee business without the need to be physically present within the parliamentary complex in Dublin. At the moment, members can participate remotely in committee business, whether it's select meetings dealing with legislation or joint meetings where we have outside witnesses, but they must be on the Leinster House complex. So they must be coming from, like I am today, from my parliamentary office. So that could just give you a flavour of what we're looking at here in Ireland at the moment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Norton. That was a fantastic flavour. Gareth Vermilion, as Director of Legislative Services, you perhaps have the privilege of the not being the elected person here today, but perhaps that gives an insight that we don't have. Would you like to explain how the Flemish Parliament managed over this period, please?
Of course, I'll be happy to. And greetings from Brussels. And thank you for having us, for inviting us to give us the possibility to explain what we have done during the last more or less 2 years. So in principle, Flemish Parliament has its meetings in Brussels. Our standing rules determine that, so by the way. But we switched to virtual and hybrid meetings, but it depends. So I have to make a distinction between the plenary sessions and the committee meetings. So the plenary meetings continue to be physical meetings, but we have 124 members of parliament, and we've had, as far as the presence of those MPs goes, We've had limited meetings. So during the different phases of the pandemic, we've had meetings, physical meetings, purely physical meetings, with the exception of the voting. I'll explain in a minute. We've had purely physical plenary meetings with not the 124 MPs present, but most of the time, either 39, we've had a period with 39 members present. In the last 6-7 months, we've had 70 of them present. The others had to stay at home or elsewhere. They couldn't come because of the rules of social distance, etc. And we have had our debates with a limited number of MPs present. The debates. So those were not hybrid meetings. The members who were not present in Brussels couldn't participate in the debates. But at the moment the pandemic started, our IT guys immediately wrote an IT application to enable the MPs to vote from elsewhere, from home or wherever they were. So voting in the plenary meetings always took place via that application, so from a distance. Also, the members who were present physically had to use the new digital application to vote. And it worked perfectly, so they did a hell of a job. But the plenary sessions kept on being physical meetings with a limited number of MPs physically present. The committee meetings, that's another thing. We immediately switched to, in the beginning, purely digital, virtual, video call meetings. So, with few exceptions, it could be decided to have physical meetings for the committees, but in general we had purely virtual meetings, so no hybrid meetings. Hybrid for us means that members can choose to be physically present or to participate from a distance. Purely virtual means that they couldn't come to Brussels, they had to stay away, with the exception of the chairman of the committee. He or she had to be present in Brussels together with the committee clerk. We always, it was decided that someone should be physically present to be able technically to broadcast our committee meetings. All our committee meetings in principle are public meetings, and we broadcast them with a live stream, and to be able to organize that technically from a technical point of view, someone had to be present, and it was decided that not only the civil servant, not only the committee clerk had to be present, but also the chairman of the committee, so the MP chairing the committee had to be there. In the beginning, we only had one committee room, which was technically to organize hybrid meetings. In the meantime, we have six. And during the period of the pandemic, there was a tendency to go back to normal as far as possible. And we organized ourselves in a way that not only purely virtual meetings became possible, but also hybrid meetings, so that the members can choose to be physically present or to participate from a distance, and also the ministers. And it works. Virtual meetings, it works. Hybrid meetings, it works. The debates can take place. Ministers can be, members of government can be questions, etc., etc. Maybe one of the reasons that it's me, that it's a civil servant who is talking to you at this moment, is the fact that the opinions within the Flemish parliaments, among the MPs, go in quite different directions as far as the future goes, because in the meantime, we're back to normal and there are no longer measures to COVID measures. But there are no longer any measures, so we can go back to normal. But it was decided that the committees itself themselves can choose to either have purely physical meetings or hybrid meetings. So our committees keep on meeting hybridly, and we continue to have hybrid meetings. I think maybe 60-70% of our committee meetings take place of our hybrid meetings at the moment.
That's very helpful.
So there are, our MPs have very strong opinions about physical meetings versus hybrid meetings. So some of them are very, very much in favor of hybrid meetings.
That's very helpful, and I think that's part of what the intention of this morning is to explore. I would like just to start taking the privilege of convener to talk about proxy voting, but I know, well, I understand that certainly, Mr. Norton, that again your constitution prevents proxy voting, but I was just wondering whether or not there is any growing tied towards proxy voting to allow access during times when elected members perhaps should be able to take off the elected member's hat because of personal circumstances, but that their constituents still to be represented. I wonder whether you had any thoughts on that, Mr. Norton.
No, I think from our experience, it has been that there has been a demand from members to actually getting back to physical voting in the chamber. As I say, we had a reduced voting system for a period of time where only one third of members were present, and that reflected the view of all of the different groupings and parliamentary parties or parties within Parliament. But no, there doesn't seem to be demand. The demand seems to be very much that we would actually try and confine the voting to a specific period over the parliamentary week so that members could plan their time around that. And what we have tried to do in both the last parliament and in this parliament is have the voting business on a Wednesday afternoon, Wednesday evening, and dispose of all of the votes during that particular period. So that is also the time then that most of the parliamentary parties would meet their colleagues, and it would also be when all of the other political groupings would have their group meetings to decide policy issues. So we've tried to truncate that aspect where people are all required to be physically present in Parliament to that particular period to provide that level of flexibility. But there isn't a demand for remote voting from members.
Do you think that comes from the cultural importance of your parliaments physically meeting in set spaces? I mean, as you say, it is one of the fundamental precepts of the constitution that the parliament should physically meet, and the sort of demand for transparency and understanding drives and perhaps overshadows individual circumstances that mean that they can't attend?
Well, look, I think, I'd be a very strong advocate to expand as much of the remote participation as we can. And I chair one of the parliamentary committees and I facilitate that as much as I can as chair of that committee. But I think we need to remember that politics is the art of compromise. And that a lot of the parliamentary work is not done on the floor of the chamber. It can be done over a cup of coffee. For example, even this week, I've had engagement with three separate ministers on three different pieces of legislation where I'm pushing a particular approach. One of them was in the lobby within the chamber itself before voting. One was outside the committee room after discussing a piece of legislation, and one was over a cup of coffee in the canteen. So, you know, those aspects are very important in terms of trying to get compromises, trying to get solutions in terms of the passage of legislation. And they don't happen in the chamber itself. And I think, you know, that is an important part of Parliament. Parliament isn't just about the chamber. It is about the complex itself, the engagement that takes place bilaterally or multilaterally, you know, before legislation is presented on the floor of the House.
That's very, very helpful. Mr. Vermilion, again, my understanding is that the Flemish Parliament don't have a proxy voting for members who can't attend. But is there a view to move to that, or has the electronic voting that's come along perhaps removed any demand for it?
Well, we went, in the meantime, we went back to normal. So the voting takes place in normal circumstances by pushing a button physically in the meeting room, and we switched back to that kind of voting, so that the voting from a distance doesn't happen anymore for this moment. But part of the MPs are very much in favor to install that way of voting also for the future. For example, to members who are sick, for example, and who can't attend because of their sickness, but they are well enough to be able to watch the meeting on television or on their computer screen from a distance, and to participate in voting at the end of the meeting. That's something on which discussions take place for the moment. But I think there's no majority to go in that direction. So I think that the physical presence will keep on being necessary to be able to participate in voting in the future.
Thank you. That's very helpful. I'm going to pass over to Colette Stevenson, a member of the committee, who has some questions. Colette.
Okay. Thanks, Convener, and good morning to you. And I really wanted to explore in terms of your views on the virtual and hybrid way of working. And there has been, you know, suggestions that, you know, and you've mentioned it yourself about unintended consequences and disadvantages to some members as they're not present in the actual, you know, in Parliament itself. And I know from some of the statistics that have come out, the House of Lords said that there was more contributions that increased because there was a hybrid arrangement in place as well, albeit there was a slight decline in the number of different members actually contributing. So it was really just to explore your views on, you know, what you think the barriers are to change and how a balance could maybe be found there. And if I could direct my question, I've completely forgotten your name. My apologies. Mr. Naughton, sorry. My apologies.
Yes, I think we need to look at how we can address barriers. And I think, COVID has changed the dynamic of Parliament. There's absolutely no doubt about it. I think we're all more used to using remote tools now. I use it on a weekly basis in terms of dealing with constituents where, you know, I was physically travelling to meetings the length and breadth of my constituency. Now some of those meetings are taking place remotely, even with community groups. Even when I'm here in Parliament, I can now have meetings with groups in my own constituency at the same time. So that I think is very important. Apologies, that's the committee bell, I think, that's just kicking off there. So apologies in relation to that. But I think it is important that we look at how we can remove as many barriers as possible. One of the things that I have been advocating is the whole area of witness evidence being given before a parliamentary committee. At the moment, in order to have privilege, that witness must present within the precincts of Leinster House. It does require a change in the legislation so that they would have privilege no matter where they present from. And I chair the parliamentary committee that has covers responsibility in terms of policy for our island communities. So we've had quite a number of members from island communities that have participated in the committee proceedings, which would normally take them 3 days to physically travel to Dublin, give evidence and travel home. Now they can do it at sitting at their kitchen table. I think the what we're trying to do at the moment is explore this idea of a number of regional hubs so that members of Parliament could actually participate, particularly in committee hearings, from one of those regional hubs rather than having to physically travel to Dublin for every single meeting. I think doing that and then confining the voting to the Wednesday afternoon, Wednesday evening, I think is a good compromise. It allows for more flexibility in terms of engagement, members not having to travel to Dublin as much, but also provides them with what I believe is important, that ability to engage with colleagues. And, you know, I think the parliamentary whips probably would be very anxious to keep the physical voting in place. I, for one, was a member of a government and voted against that government back a number of years ago and went against the party whip. And I knew that I had to physically vote inside in Parliament, and every other member of the government was looking directly at me when I pressed that button against the government. So it does make it more difficult to vote against the government. The other side of it is you need that collegiality in terms of difficult decisions that have to be made to be able to vote with colleagues on those. And you can really only build up that relationship once you have those interpersonal relationships built up already. I think one of the things that has come out of COVID-19 is that surveys have shown that 44% of people have reported that they have found it harder to build trust with co-workers through this remote process. I think that also applies to Parliament. And in our case, we had our parliamentary election on the month before COVID hit Ireland. So there is that deficit there, particularly among newer members.
OK, thank you very much. And if I could direct the same question to Garrett, please.
Of course. I must say, I have to second almost everything Mr. Norton has said, especially as far as flexibility goes. So the virtual and hybrid meetings, committee meetings especially, make it possible, for example, to easily invite, for example, foreign experts for hearings or to give evidence in a committee meeting without having to travel to Brussels, etc. So I'm convinced that hybrid meetings will be staying among us. So we were obliged to learn to use those new possibilities, and we have learned what the advantages are, of course. So we'll keep on using it when necessary, of course. On the other hand, there's a strong feeling amongst a lot of members of Parliament that the quality of the debates suffers from using those hybrid possibilities. And as I said earlier, we broadcast all our plenary and committee meetings, and broadcasting a virtual or a hybrid meeting, it must be, we don't have a lot of viewers in normal circumstances, we don't have them, but to have to watch a parliamentary meeting which takes place in a hybrid parliamentary meeting, I'm sorry to say, but that must be horrible. It really is not attractive at all. one of the reasons for that is that the debate simply is not as feeling as in a physical environment.
Okay, no, thanks very much. Sorry to cut you off, but you want to continue?
No problem.
Okay, convener, I've got no further questions, thanks.
Thank you, and I'm glad to see that no matter where the Parliament sits, we're all governed by bells ringing in various places. Bob, could I come over to you for your set of questions, please?
Yeah, of course, convener. Putting to one side any technical issues with hybrid, the dynamics of debate and interventions and all that, Mr. Mountain may raise some of those issues in relation to the opportunities of a hybrid parliament, not by default, but where there's maybe a caring need or a long-term condition or parents or a disability or another reason, that flexibility for individual members. Does either of our witnesses, maybe start with Dennis Naughton, think there's opportunities there in terms of retention of members of Parliament who have difficulties with work-life balance or have other barriers they have to overcome? And I'll roll both questions together, convener, for time constraints here. By definition, those MSPs we have in Parliament have overcome those barriers. Some think the price to pay is too much and then leave the Parliament. But there's lots of people who don't decide to stand for election because of the nature of Parliament, because of the challenges and the barriers that they have, be that BAME groups, disabled people with long-term conditions, people juggling family life. Are there opportunities in relation to a hybrid Parliament to make all our legislators look a little bit more like the society that we all represent? So retention of work-life balance, but also making those legislators more diverse and more representative. So maybe come to Dennis Naughton first.
Yes, definitely. I think there are opportunities there in relation to hybrid working. I, for one, at the end of January, ended up having COVID. So I had to isolate, but I was still able to chair meetings of the committee. There were private meetings, but I was still able to chair those. I was still able to participate in other parliamentary meetings that weren't being broadcast. So it did facilitate that happening. And it provides for a level of consistency. If you have the same members at the same meetings every week, it's much easier to get decisions. So I'm a member of the business committee, which decides the schedule each week. If we had different members turning up every second week, it would be much harder to get agreement. You build up a relationship and a rapport with regard to that. And I think there is an opportunity, absolutely, in terms of illness or physical disability. And we've had members who, for one reason or another, are immunocompromised, and they have been able to participate actively in meetings from their parliamentary office, which wouldn't have been possible for them if that facility wasn't available to them. And I think there is an opportunity, absolutely, in terms of people with disabilities, people that are isolated for one reason or another, to contribute either as members of Parliament or to the parliamentary process. For example, I chair the Social Protection Committee. It is very hard to actually get family carers as witnesses before a committee hearing because of their commitments. They can't give that time, where it is possible for them to give evidence remotely. And I think the opportunity is there to do that. I think there's also an opportunity if you have a minister maybe that is not available or avoiding engagement with a committee, you know, saying that maybe they're out of the country. Our ministers have to attend the Council of Ministers at European Union level. There's no reason why they can't plug in remotely in relation to that. In relation to the other aspect of your question, and I think it is an important aspect, how do we increase diversity and can remote technology help in relation to that? I think remote technology can help in greater participation, particularly at committee level within our system anyway. But I would hesitate about members participating exclusively from a remote setting. We have had senators who have represented our Irish communities abroad, who were physically based in the United States, but also physically attended Parliament. And they were able to give us an insight through, you know, offline engagement in terms of some of the issues that you don't see reflected in an actual debate. And I think it's important to remember that. The other thing is, we had an election back in 2020, in February 2020. We have a lot of new, very capable TDs now, but they haven't had the opportunity to learn. Because remember, the parliamentary process is an apprenticeship. It's about learning from seeing and learning from doing. And it's very hard to do that remotely. And I really feel disappointed for some of those members who haven't seen or learned the skills of the trade up to now. And I think, you know, we need as a parliament to make up that deficit with them now in terms of using the parliamentary tools that are available to them. So if you have someone that's participating exclusively remotely, yes, their voice will be heard. But will they make an impact in terms of policy changes? Will they make an impact in terms of legislative changes? I think it's very hard to do that remotely because so much happens through the interpersonal engagement with ministers, with their officials, the people who are drafting legislation, not necessarily physically in the committee or in plenary session of Parliament.
Thank you, Mr. Morton, for that. That's a point very well made. I'm not sure of suggestions we've had that it should be exclusively remotely, but you make a really good point about those relationships have to be built and fostered and nurtured in the first place before you can get that really positive dynamic with hybrid. And I think we're grasping with that here in the Scottish Parliament as well. So thank you for putting that on the record. Gerrit, do you want to come in and give your observations to the questions asked?
Gladly. Concerning work-life balance, we've seen that at the time and during the period the plenary sessions took place physically, of course, but with a limited number of members, that at Wednesday afternoon or Wednesday evening when we have our plenary votes, most of the members could participate in voting. So 124 MPs. And we, during all that period, we've had at least 115 to 120 members participating in the plenary voting. Now that we are back to physical voting, those who are present can vote, the others not, we see that about 100 to 105 members participate and are present. So, thanks to the virtual voting system we've had during the COVID period, more members participated in voting. And I suppose work-life balance could play a role. We see that, for example, MPs who have small children are very much in favor of hybrid meetings and continuing to have hybrid committee meetings. But not only work-life balance, but also what I'd like to call work-work balance. For example, other MPs who are very much in favor of hybrid meetings are those who are mayor of their own town or village and who have work in their own town as well, being the mayor or have some other responsibilities in governing their own town. So work-life balance and work-work balance, I think. But as I said earlier, yes, hybrid meetings give us a lot of opportunities to operate in a more flexible way. But can that play a role in encouraging other profiles to participate in elections and to go for public office? I don't believe it. I really am convinced that that doesn't play any role at all, that that wouldn't make a difference or doesn't make a difference. But once they are elected, it surely gives more possibilities and more flexibility for the elected members of Parliament.
Okay. Thank you, Gerrit Vermeulen. No further questions, convener.
Thank you very much, Bob. Can I hand over to you, Edward, please?
Thank you, Convener, and I'll try and keep this short because a lot of the questions have been answered, but I'd like to come to Dennis, if I may, first. First of all, I'm delighted to know that the parliamentary privilege exists for your parliament. It doesn't exist for the parliament in Scotland, and that anything we say is not subject to privilege. I think that your point about politics and relationships is really well made, and I hark back to evidence we heard from somebody else. You don't bump into people on WhatsApp, and I think that's right. So actually having the ability to talk to people is really important. Dennis, have you watched other parliaments debating in a hybrid format? And if so, do you think they're informative or sterile?
Yes, I suppose, look, I have watched other parliaments in the hybrid process, and I do believe that they are stale. And I think, you know, body language is a key issue. And I was talking to some of your colleagues last week. I serve on the Interparliamentary Union Working Group on Science and Technology. We were elected last April of 2021, and we had all remote meetings up until last December, and we're working on a particular paper. And last December we had our first opportunity to physically meet, and we did more in the 3 hours that we physically had met in the previous 8 months of work, because none of us had met each other before that. We're 21 parliamentarians from across the globe, and body language, facial expression, all of that played a key role in actually progressing, you know, an international paper that we're working on. So I see it as being very important. I served on the EU Council of Ministers, and particularly there where you have, you know, 27 member states and 27 ministers, that interpersonal relationship that you build up with your colleagues makes a huge difference in actually getting agreement. And as EU level, you have to get agreement. So I see how important that is in relation to it. In terms of going back to your question regarding the actual debates themselves, they are a bit staged. But look, I think Parliament, particularly in second stage debates, are quite stagnant anyway, and I think have become more so in our Parliament anyway since COVID-19, because we had a restriction that debates could only last for 2 hours. Then plenary had to be ceased and the whole place sanitised before you started again. And we're now finding even though the time restrictions are removed, a lot of debates are not lasting much longer than those 2 hours. So it actually has spilled over into the day-to-day plenary aspect of it now, which I think is a concern. And I think it's something that we do need to be conscious of. One other thing that I think is important that we think about as well, and that is, you know, absolutely, hybrid working has been great. It has reduced the amount of travel we as members of Parliament do, travelling across our constituencies, or travelling to and from Parliament in Dublin or Edinburgh, wherever it is. But we're also losing that bit of time while we're travelling, you know, travelling in the car on our own, that time to mull over a problem, to contemplate it. And the reality is that many of the very good, innovative policy developments that take place in that period in the car when we're on our own, undistracted. And in today's society where we have technology all around us, where the phone is there the whole time, whether it's WhatsApp or emails, you know, having that bit of time and space is also important to contemplate a problem and come forward with a practical solution that can get the agreement of your parliamentary colleagues and your peers right across the parliamentary divide.
I'm not sure my office would agree with you, because when I leave on the train at 5:30 and start firing off emails, I'm not sure they're particularly pleased with that. Gerard, if I could just come to you and just ask you a very brief question. If you think, and the question is, do you think ministers, when they're called before a committee or the parliament, can be held properly to account if they're doing it virtually? Or do you think they just waffle on and talk the clock down and there's no way of controlling them? Difficult one for you to answer that, Garrett, but I'm sure you'll do it.
Not really. No, I think it doesn't make a difference. They also, how did you call it, waffle on? They also waffle on in physical meetings. So it really doesn't make a difference, I think. So they can be held accountable also in a virtual way of working. I don't think it. Maybe it's a cultural thing also. But really, I don't see any reason to tell you that it can make a difference. But maybe I can add something, and I don't know if they are allowed in your parliaments, if you are allowed, but a lot of members and even sometimes ministers tend to mute their camera during hybrid meetings when they participate from a distance. And that's Mr. Norton talked about body language, eye contact, etc., which is of course more difficult in hybrid meetings, but impossible when participants mute their camera. So it's really, pardon my French, it's a pain in the ass that there's a tendency to do that. Other members participating or viewers don't even know whether that MP is present or not. And you can mute your camera and go do something else in the garden or whatever. And that's something which takes place here, and about which we make remarks. We ask them not to do that, but it doesn't really help. So that's another element. But it's something which is taking place and which doesn't help to make hybrid meetings attractive to participate in and to watch.
Thank you. And yes, our broadcasting services actually control our cameras. So if you type away from keyboard, they don't turn them on. But I'm always conscious of being in the room with the convener that we have at the moment, because you get a glare when you're overstating your welcome or speech, and I can feel that pouring into me at the moment. So I'm going to hand back to the convener. It would be more physically threatening if I was in the room with him rather than just doing it remotely. Convener, thank you very much.
I'm very grateful for your empathy there, Edward. I think, Mr. Norton, you wanted to comment on that as well. Can I just come to you before I pass on to the final committee member?
Yeah, and look, I'll be very brief, but I've been on both sides of the table, being a minister before the committee under scrutiny, chairing the meetings, and being someone that has quizzed ministers in the past. And I think having a minister physically present is much easier. It's much more difficult to avoid the questions. And it's not just the questions, but it's the reaction of your government colleagues inside in the committee room as well to what you're saying. So it's not purely the response that you're giving to the individual member, but the reaction and the facial expressions that you can see from your colleagues. Now, we've been lucky that in our procedure, ministers have always had their camera on throughout the committee hearing, whereas it's taken place remotely. Personally, I believe the default should be that ministers should be physically present unless there is a real and justifiable and legitimate reason why they would not be. And it's not just because of the engagement, but a lot of the time, again, you know, you can have a discussion maybe with the official that's advising the minister offline outside of the committee meeting, and maybe get a better insight into why the minister is taking a particular position on a particular issue, and that may lead to getting a compromise solution on the issue. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'm slightly conscious of time, but I'd like to draw in Tess White. Tess?
Thank you. Good morning. I think Mr. Norton's just answered that question, but I would like to go to Mr. Vermeulen, if I may, please. So in terms of the hybrid proceedings and the impact on openness and transparency? So that's a philosophical question. Mr. Vermeulen, can you share with us your high-level view in relation to representative democracy?
I should... You're almost forcing me to give you my personal opinion about the whole business of hybrid and physical meetings, etc. But I'll be happy to give you my opinion. If I were the one to decide on how Parliament should work, although there are certainly advantages, although it gives extra opportunities and it gives more flexibility, more possibilities in terms of time management for the MPs, etc., etc. A parliament which takes itself seriously and takes the debating and the everything happening in parliament seriously and wants to work in an optimal, in the best possible circumstances, should have only physical meetings. It's virtual or hybrid meetings wouldn't take place in Flemish parliaments if I were the one to decide on that topic. It's as simple and plain as that.
If I can just follow up, just a final one, so that's very helpful to be clear. In terms of transparency and robust scrutiny, is that the reason why you say that?
Absolutely.
Okay, perfect. That clocked.
Absolutely, yes.
Okay, thank you. And then, Mr. Norton, could you give your philosophical view as well on that question in relation to representative democracy and hybrid proceedings?
Well, look, I think we're seeing right across the world at the moment a polarisation in terms of political positions in many parliaments and in many countries. And, you know, I think if you were only having a remote parliament or a hybrid parliament, I think that polarisation would actually snowball. I think it is important. Parliament is just not about the chamber, the plenary chamber or the committee chamber. It's about the engagement that takes place within the precincts of Parliament, indirectly with ministers, with, you know, various interest groups that give us their view, engagement with other colleagues and trying to find solutions on particular parliamentary issues. So I think it is important that you have that physical presence. I think we should try, insofar as is possible, to try and facilitate as many voices in terms of the deliberations that take place. And I think hybrid can facilitate that, both in terms of members who, for one reason or another, cannot be physically present to give their perspective on a particular issue, or witnesses. But I think ultimately, you know, decisions need to be made physically in Parliament, and that you do need that physical element to it. And I think that is imperative.
Thank you. That's very good. Very clear. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tess. And that brings us to the end of our selected questions. So can I thank both of you for attending this second panel today? It's been fascinating. And to have the opportunity to hear from other legislatures, an advantage of IT. Always a disappointment that we can't share a cup of coffee or a cup of tea. And for that chat outside of the room, where certainly I think all parliamentarians are aware that so much of the work is done. But Mr. Norton, TD, and Mr. Vermeulen, Director of Legislative Services, can I thank you very much for your contributions today. Thank you. That draws to an end the public aspect of this meeting, and therefore I close this meeting.